standard operating procedure.
Call this meeting of the Sarasota Manatee MPO to order and ask Councilman Roth to do the invocation.
Dear God, we thank you for these rains that are recharging our aquifers. We thank you for the citizens and the public officials who are willing to serve and care about this community to make long-range planning. We hope that you please help us to make wise and good decisions for the whole community and to serve you and your needs. Amen.
Amen.
You all please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. Eubanks, do we have a quorum?
Yes, we
do. Before I open this meeting to the public, I have a piece of paper here that is suitable for framing. In fact, it already is framed. It is made of very new paper, thin bituminous concrete material with wide shoulders, and it does not need repair except occasionally if it has an intersection with a roundabout. So I would like to read this piece of paper in honor of our executive director who will be leading us. Whereas Michael P. Howe served over 13 years with the Sarasota Manatee Metropolitan Planning Organization beginning in 2002. And whereas Michael served as planning manager for 3 years and was appointed executive director in 2005. And whereas Michael has represented the Sarasota Manatee MPO in numerous regional and statewide transportation planning processes and activities, including the Metropolitan Planning Organization Advisory Committee, MPOAC, the West Central Florida Chairs Coordinating Committee, CCC, and the Coordinated Urban Transportation Studies, CUTS. And whereas Michael was elected chair 2008-2010 of the MPO Advisory Council Directors, representing all 26 MPOs in the state, and also served as chair of the MPO Advisory Council Revenue Study Committee. And whereas Michael also served as chair of the MPO Advisory Council's Transportation Revenue Study, which identified funding options for consideration by the Florida legislature. And whereas Michael has developed positive working relationships with local elected officials serving on the MPO, and under his direction, the MPO staff has worked to obtain funding for many important projects throughout the region. And whereas Michael has maintained and strengthened statewide respect of the Sarasota Manatee MPO among peer organizations and with state and federal officials, and whereas Michael will complete his service to the Sarasota Manatee MPO on August 31st, 2015, and has been a delight to work with, now therefore the board wishes to honor Michael P. Howe and recognize him for his outstanding service to the region and wish him well in his future. Mr. Howe, if you would receive this bituminous concrete paper thin testimony. All right, now for the public, I have Mr. Benz. Ms. Benz. Can't tell here. Next time.
Good morning. My name is Kathy Benz, and I'm a member of your CAC and a former chair of it. I was appointed to the CAC in 2000 and have sat on it since that time. As you know, on Thursday, July 9, my friend Rod Warner died. He was my colleague on the Metropolitan Planning Organization Citizen Advisory Committee and a fellow advocate for modern roundabouts and safer road intersections. In 2000, I was appointed to the MPO CAC and immediately pursued the introduction of modern roundabouts to the MPO CAC, the MPO board, as well as to the government governing boards of the city and the county by introducing Michael Wallwork and his road design concepts to them one at a time. Once I had won over Rod Warner, and that was a task initially, he joined my efforts with the same passion. By the spring of 2002, Michael Wallwork was touring potential sites in the Bi-County MPO region with Michael Howe while preparing recommendations for the MPO CAC, the MPO TAC, and the full MPO board via a roundabout task force that arose from our MPO CAC. Some of that unfolding history is related in the attached email exchange between Rod and me, and there are some additional copies of this information that will be available for you. Graciously, Rod began to identify himself as Kathy's disciple when he introduced me to people, an example of his humility and inspiring inclusiveness that won over many before the road engineering did. To date, both of us had been appointed to the MPO CAC at the end of each term. After consideration of modern roundabouts became a subject that might come before our committee, our collaboration was hampered by the sunshine regulations, and Rod possessed computer and broadcasting skills and equipment that led to his naturally becoming the more visible leader of our local efforts. Added to that, his communication and organizational skills eventually led to national prominence as an advocate and, as you know, eventually paved the way for his 2011 appointment to the Federal Highway Administration Task Force for Modern Roundabouts. More recently, he and I were designated to assist the city manager and in Sarasota and the landscape designer with the application of national standards that have developed for use in modern roundabouts and practical applications that facilitate them. His contributions to advising on mobility issues is well documented. I urge you to prepare a memorial resolution for Rod and to present it to his family in time. And I also urge you to consider dedicating a library of documents related to modern roundabouts at the MPO offices to the memory of Rod Warner, honoring the significant contributions of one who led the way to the implementation of these intersection designs in our region and rose to national recognition that reflects our dedication. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. Any other members of the public wish to speak? If not, we'll move on to our next item, which is Mr. Popescu speaking for the CAC.
Good morning, Mr. Chair. We're all missing Rod Warner. We called him Round Warner. We always made fun, but he worked so hard. He dedicated practically all his life. And he will be missed. He's been with the CAC for at least 15 years. I know about 6 years ago, Sarasota County awarded him the 10-year recognition. We did meet the citizen advisory. We did meet on July 9. And as far as our actions, we did have a quorum. We voted to recommend your approval of the amended CAC bylaws. Your copies will have in blue very small revisions that we made. Those revisions were sent to your attorney, and so far there was no objection, so we suggest to be incorporated in our bylaws. Also, we had a presentation made by Mr. Nick Lapp, he's here, about recommended needs for the 2014 long-range transportation plan. We approved it with several comments that he agreed to consider, for instance, transit improvements and bike lanes in the city of Northport that one of our members recommended. Our committee also, we received presentation on financial resources and revenue projection for 2040 long range plan. We had a presentation about Sarasota County mobility plan, which was very interesting. We presentation on a U.S. traffic separator project in the city of Sarasota, 15th Street, PD&E study, and US 41 Main Street roundabout presentation. I want to thank you. Last month, on another subject, I asked the members, the county members and the city members, to look into. We had a lot of vacancies in our citizen advisory. As of today, we have no vacancy. Either they have been filled, or they were advertised recently, so they will be filled shortly. I want to thank you very much for it. That concludes my presentation, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Appreciate that. And. Before we move on to the next item, I had suspected Mr. Popescu would have a comment about Rod. We'll have a moment's silence in his memory. Thank you. Next is Ms. Wiggins for the TAC.
Good morning, Board. The TAC met with a quorum on July 13th. In addition to approving the minutes from our June 8th meeting, the committee took action on a couple of items, one being the amended TAC bylaws, which the committee recommended approval with several changes. Also, we took action on the draft needs plan for the 2040 long-range plan with several modifications. The TAC also heard several presentations on the financial resources and revenue projections for the 2040 Long Range Transportation Plan, the Sarasota County Mobility Plan, the US 41 Traffic Separator Project in the City of Sarasota, the 15th Street East US 301 Boulevard PD&E study in Manatee County, as well as the US 41 and Main Street PD&E study in the City of Sarasota. And that concluded our meeting.
Thank you very much. Next, Mr. Henry, for the BPTAC.
Good morning. Our last meeting was held July 13th. We had good attendance and had a quorum. We had four presentations after looking at the meeting this morning. I'm not going to go into any depth because they're going to go through them again. But we had a presentation about the mobility plan. Our takeaway was that we considered a mobility plan more proactive instead of a reactive plan. The FDOT made a presentation on the 15th Street, US 301 East. We also had a presentation about the roundabout for US 41 and Main Street. And we also had a report for the traffic separator, which is on the agenda as well. Going around the table, the City of Venice is getting approval to hire a bicycle pedestrian coordinator starting October the 1st. There's going to be a public hearing July 30th, 4 to 6 p.m. at the Laurel Community Center for the new Legacy Trail pedestrian bridge. And the city of Northport held a summer camp for kids and had a very good turnout. Approximately 130 kids were fitted for helmets and had a bicycle safety course, so that was considered a success. Mr. Patrick Cluey of Sarasota County is working on an in-depth analysis of the crash data this summer. And in the last meeting, we talked about the 3-foot law sign. It's been decided by FDOT that there's no provisions to use this sign, so it can be only used by local jurisdictions. That concludes my presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Henry. As you all can see, the work of these committees is extensive, and they keep us from having to deal with something. If it's really bad, it never gets here, along with staff. We have a pretty good review body that makes our life easier. I'd like to take this moment to see if any of you have any questions of these three chairs. Thank you. We'll not have a PTTF report because it did not meet this month. And I think it meets next in, I have the schedule in front of me, but of course, I'm not looking at it at the moment, and therefore I can't tell you. I think it meets next in
October.
In October.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll now have the FDOT report. Ms. Lockwood or Roxanne, either one or both. Take your turns.
Good morning. I just want to give a couple updates about some public hearings that are upcoming. Tomorrow, July 28th, the department's going to have a public hearing about the improvements to the US 301 at Haven Boulevard intersection to improve safety and reduce the risk of crashes. Also, the Florida Department of Transportation will be holding an open house about a new pedestrian bridge over Laurel Road for the Legacy Trail. The public meeting open house is from 4 to 6 on Thursday, July 30th. At the Laurel Community Center in Nokomis. The DOT will hold this meeting to give interested people the opportunity to review the displays and talk one-on-one with the staff. Also, on US 41 and Hanson Street, the department invites the community and travelers to a public hearing about improvements to the US 41 and Hanson Street intersection to improve safety and reduce the risk of crashes. The hearing is from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. August 4th at the Southside Baptist Church, Magnolia Street in Sarasota. The hearing consists of an open house from 5 to 5:30, allowing people to view displays, ask questions, and discuss one-on-one with the members of the project team. And just a reminder, in case anybody forgot about the groundbreaking ceremony, the department is hosting a groundbreaking ceremony at 1 p.m. Tuesday, August the 4th, along Market Street, adjacent to University Parkway in Bradenton. And then one last thing. We had a project come to our attention, a safety project on State Road 758, Midnight Pass Road at State Road 72. It's going to be a quick safety project to address some safety improvements at that location. What they plan to do is reduce the turning radius on the northeast corner, remove the northbound acceleration lane taper on 758, provide a bicycle lane northbound on State Road 758 on the north side of the intersection, provide a bicycle lane on the State Road 72 westbound approach to the intersection, reconstruct the ADA ramps, realign the signal head to match proposed changes, mill and resurface State Road 72 and State Road 758 so the removal of the old pavement markings will not be visible. The majority of this work will take approximately 1 week. After they mill and resurface, they will come back within a couple weeks to put the striping down. As I said, this is a safety project that should take no longer than 3 weeks. And then one last thing. Commissioner Chappie had requested last month about some information on the street lighting on Cortez Road around 119th Street. I'm working with some of the project managers. There's two or three other projects ongoing or upcoming, so we're working together to see if there's anything in there that we can work with or if there's something we can add to. And that's all I have.
Does anyone have any questions for Ms. Lake, yes, Mr. Chaffee.
Just switching over to Manatee Avenue, there's a project for streetlights from 59th to 75th. It was supposed to start sometime after July 1st. I'm just wondering if you have a timeline on that?
Yeah, currently the project's in material acquisition. The project is set to start construction August 25th, 2015.
And then at the intersection on Manatee Avenue at Village Green Parkway, there's some issues with the turn lanes there and the timing. And are there any improvements or anything scheduled for that?
I'll have to double check. Nothing comes to mind at this time. I've had to get with the project manager to see.
Sorry, I forgot to give you a heads up before the meeting.
That's all right.
On that one.
We'll talk about that.
Yes, Mayor.
Mine is really more maybe operational for us. The Haven Boulevard, the meeting that's going to be held in Ellington at the church. My concern is because it affects several jurisdictions and because of the momentum that the Economic Development Corporation is working on in that area with Feld and so forth, there may be several members from this board attending, I would imagine. So I just wondered if there has been a public notice. My commission has done that, but I wasn't aware if this board had done that or needed to do that.
The answer.
Yeah.
I know it's been put out through the DOT because it is tomorrow for the July 28th for the public hearing. Mm-hmm. But I know we've put it in the newspaper a couple times.
Yeah, I've seen those. I don't think we need an MPO notice as long as there is a public notice, but something to consider. I mean, a notice that we generate internally, like emails to all of us. Is that what you're thinking?
No, I'm thinking as far as the public recognizing that there will be several of the board members there, so there's no conflicts.
Yeah.
So that's a sunshine question.
Exactly. And I just wanted to make sure, because my commission, we've already posted at City Hall, but I didn't think ahead to this meeting, because looking at the county commissioners here, I think there will likely be, because of the importance of that corridor, there will likely be more. Yeah.
I know in our local jurisdiction, and maybe in yours, when we have that situation, we normally just don't say anything. But we'll try to see if we can set up something ahead of time for the next round of that type of thing. Yes, Mr. Howe?
No, Chair, we're fortunate to have the MPO legal counsel here, Robert Essenfelter from Manatee County, Assistant County Attorney. And I'd like him to address that since it was raised, which is a legitimate question in the state of Florida. It's always something we want to take seriously. Go ahead, Rob.
That's good. Good morning, Bob.
Good morning, members. And Mike, by the way, as you exit, I am promoted, so I'm Chief Assistant County Attorney.
Oh, my God. My last meeting, that's, I blew your title?
We will still remain friends for that.
Yeah, all right. And you're Emperor of Manatee County.
I'll make you one of my leeges. The question I think is, if multiple members of the MPO attend some other body's meeting, does the MPO need to put out a meeting notice? And the answer to that is no. It comes up all the time, with our county commission and probably most bodies, where there's concern, where two or more of you all know you're going to be someplace. You can certainly put it on your personal calendars, as our commissioners often do, but it is not a meeting of the MPO or any subcommittee of the MPO, and so if multiple of you intend to be there, you just must follow the Sunshine Law, which says that two or more of you cannot discuss outside of a noticed MPO meeting MPO business. So one of you can sit there, and one of you can sit there, and you can even ask questions in front of each other, and you can make comments, but you cannot turn to each other and start discussing a matter that would reasonably be coming back to the MPO.
That's good. That's a little better than our quiet rule. Yes, Ms. Chapman.
Just a word of warning. That is exactly the issue that's being litigated in my case. Exactly the issue. So people should be very aware that it is being litigated by Citizens for Sunshine, that you just go to a meeting and listen and do not discuss among yourselves an issue that's likely to come before the body. You are violating the Sunshine Law. And that's their position.
Well, and again, just understand, if it is a meeting of the city of Sarasota, that's a different story. But if it is a meeting of a regional planning council or something like that, and members of this body who may not be on that body but want to hear, want to talk, whatever, you can go. But if Sarasota calls a meeting and two or more Sarasota members come, that's a Sarasota meeting, and you probably should notice that. But if the meeting that y'all or some of you are contemplating going to is not an MPO meeting or an MPO subcommittee meeting, then just go.
Well, you should be aware that the meeting that I attended was not a meeting of the city of Sarasota. It was a meeting of constituents. And so that is a live issue that's being litigated right now.
Mr. Hutchison, I think it might be wise looking forward to have a later meeting, a part of which will get into this specialized part of Sunshine for this board. I mean, we all have our own sessions locally at the county and municipal level, but this particular piece of activity is getting a little crazy, if I may, at this point, and it'd probably be good to have a session as part of our meeting in which all of us are given a little broader background than we have time to do now. I think Bob would be perfect for that, to get into some of the ins and outs. Yes.
Just for some clarification, so from what I'm hearing from you, if there is a desire of to have flexibility for members of the same body to be able to exchange, then certainly it's optional to go ahead and publish that as a notice. But then wouldn't their minutes and so on
have to
be taken?
Here's the problem with that. If you notice it as an MPO meeting, everybody on the MPO is going to feel compelled to have to show up, because if you notice it as an MPO meeting, then you're live. You can make a motion, you can take action. Your clerk has to be there and be paid to be there to take minutes and preserve those minutes. So I understand the feeling of, geez, it's not such a big deal, let's just put out a notice. But the act of doing that means that the MPO is saying, we acknowledge this is a meeting of the MPO, and I would not counsel you to go there. And, you know, how the litigation ends up, as my commissioners know, I've written articles on Sunshine and Records. I lecture across the state on it. I'm pretty up to date on it. And so I'm pretty confident in my advice that if this is not y'all's meeting and you just want to show up and listen and participate, just don't talk to each other about MPO business and you'll be fine.
So in follow-up with that, and that was kind of one of my concerns, is that if we do notice it, there are so many other parts and pieces to comply with as far as Sunshine. So this is really no different than several commissioners going to an event or some other type of thing that the onus is upon us to know that we can exchange, we can have conversation, but it doesn't limit us from having conversations with
others.
There's
plenty of Attorney General opinions about going to Tiger Bay. There's one about multiple members going to their own Planning Commission meeting and each standing up and talking to the Planning Commission right in front of each other. Those are all deemed appropriate. I understand the entity that's suing Sarasota. I successfully defeated them as well when they sued us. And so hopefully good luck, you know, on yours. But all I can do is give y'all as this body, and I totally understand you have your own legal counsels from your other individual jurisdictions that may counsel you otherwise. But my counsel to this body is that if it's not your meeting, you don't need to notice it. Just feel free to show up. The golden rule is don't be talking to each other about stuff that is or may reasonably come before the MPO.
Anything else on this wonderful subject?
Thanks, Rob.
Okay, we will now move on to any other FDOT questions.
Mr. Chair.
Laura?
Mr. Chair.
No, I just want to mention to you all that Secretary Hathaway spoke to me at the MPOAC meeting and said that the pressure of attending all MPO meetings in the district was getting to be burdensome, so that he was not going to be able to make everyone, but he would try to make as many as he could. As you all know, he is working very hard for us and being quite successful. Thank you.
Mr. Chair? If
yes.
I may? If I may, I have a question.
Okay.
I had called and emailed, actually, Secretary Hathaway and Randall Preston the last couple of weeks about State Road 70 at Verna Bethany and also there at Verna. There's quite an issue going on there with accidents, a lot of traffic, people trying to get to and from Sarasota to Manatee and vice versa. There was a fatality down in front of the fire station about a month or so ago, and they said they were going to look into it. I haven't heard anything, but if you could just mention it to them, it'd be very helpful. Some answers on that.
Anytime you email them or call them, if you could copy me in on the email.
Okay.
Because there's so many projects that aren't ongoing that they don't always have the opportunity to tell me about it, so I could always find out ahead of time before the MPO meeting.
Okay, I'll do that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vanessa. I think maybe I was looking the other way.
You were. I had your other ear.
Anything else for FDOT? Before you step away, do you have any information update on the Venice sign on I-75, which is sort of overdue? But if you don't, you don't.
I do, but it's just not coming to me right now.
Okay.
There's some. I've seen a.
You can tell
email.
Me later.
Okay.
Thank you. Yes.
I just have a question on the US 41 widening that's going on there in the basically at the boundary of Charlotte County and Sarasota County and Northport. There's been citizens that are asking about the intersection right there by the racetrack, Cranberry. So if you can visualize where I'm saying. Is
yes.
there still opportunity for them to contact somebody with FDOT in regards to the arrows that are marked coming on to 41 from the side roads there? There's some concerns in regards to the straight and the right-hand turn being in one and the same and causing some issues. Is there opportunity to do that?
Is this a new project that's upcoming, the Cranberry
They've already
intersection?
Started,
okay.
Well, started coming from down in Charlotte County up to the Salford,
yeah,
I believe.
Okay. Yeah, just if you could send me the information, have them
okay.
email me or call me.
Okay.
I can get information and get it to the project manager or give them the project manager.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure it wasn't too late for that in the process.
I'm not sure
that.
Where the design's at.
Okay.
I'm not sure how far along the project is.
It's under construction. Okay. I'll get with you and get you some information on that.
Okay.
There's just a lot of concerns being raised about the arrows on there.
Yeah, definitely. I can get the information to the project manager.
Mr. Howe.
Roxanne.
Sir.
Do you have any update on the scope, when that might be expected for the island study that this board requested for Anna Maria Island and everything, or if Laura does, you know, just when we could expect that and
sure.
and everything.
Laura should give an update.
We are still working on that. We had a meeting last week with several of the members in the beach community that are part of that to gather some input. It's probably going to be another couple of months before we fine-tune that and are able to really give meaningful information back to the board. We just want to make sure we cover all the bases and get all of the components in there.
Thank you.
For the alternates here today, this matter came up several meetings ago when Longboat Key requested some assistance finding funds and finding a study complex for their barrier island problems, and that developed after discussion into FDOT agreeing to look into the matter in terms of both cost and scope of study for the entire Gulf front sections of Sarasota and Manatee County. So as a result of that, of course, the scope is a little broader than what Longboat Key had originally proposed, but will benefit all the municipalities in both counties. And so I think it's worth waiting for FDOT to come up with stuff that's been finally developed. Anything else? Remember, this is your best opportunity to talk to these folks face to face, other than a good social gathering. Okay, we will then move on to Mr. Howe. You are going to give your executive director's report.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you all for the kind comments and the proclamation. I very much appreciate it. It's been an honor to serve this group and your communities in the two county area, and I will miss it in many regards. Let me introduce one issue, and then I have several other follow-ups, but Mike Mayholtz, our senior transportation planner, is seated next to me, and he has some information, but let me read the introduction for Mike. At your table, you will find two maps recently updated by MPO staff. The first of these is the regional roadway network adopted by you at your April 2015 meeting. The second is a map of the River Road Interstate Connector project. Mike Mayholtz, MPO staff, senior planner, will provide you a brief explanation of each of these maps. Michael.
Thank you, Mr. Howe. For the record, Mike Mayholtz, senior transportation planner, MPO. The first map that Mr. Howe alluded to was the joint regional multimodal transportation system map. There is no changes here. There are no changes here from the map that you adopted in April, but what we did highlight on this map are the hurricane evacuation routes. A number of you had called and requested that we make sure that all of the hurricane evacuation routes in both counties were on this map, and now you can see them in the broad green line. And I believe this time we've got them all covered. We used the resources of the GIS departments of each county and got the most recent up-to-date hurricane evacuation route map. So they're all properly reflected here on this map. So I just want to make sure that you all had a copy of that. The second map, again, this is from our, this is an updated map with information from Sarasota County. At your January meeting, the joint meeting with Charlotte County MPO in January this year, we had passed out this map with information that was accurate but needed to be updated in some aspects, and we've done that now. And more specifically, to the point, segment one, which is from US 41 North to Center Road, has been divided into two segments by Sarasota County, in much in the same way they segmented the Venice Bypass to break it into smaller units to make it easier to fund and work with. The boxes of information contained there is the latest information we have from Sarasota County regarding right-of-way costs, construction costs, and some areas where those yet haven't been determined. So I want to make sure that we had said at the January meeting we would work with the county and get the most recent information for you. So it's depicted on this map, and I'd be glad to take any questions if anybody has any.
May I comment that when you get the detail on Charlotte County added to these maps, mm-hmm. you will see with the completion of Winchester Boulevard in Charlotte that we have an excellent potential storm access route out of South County and really even Boca Grande to either US 41 or I-75, depending on conditions. They may be like outside right now, the wind may be a little faster, but this is a long-term project that is developing quite nicely, I happen to think. Questions of Mr. Mayholtz on this? Yes, Patrick.
Yeah, on the first map with the hurricane evacuation routes, you mentioned that the legend shows the dark green being the, there is an olive green legend that's not specified. Are they also evacuation routes?
Yes, they are. Sometimes the color varies when you get the green against the yellow and it's a shading, but all of the, everything that
greenish
that has a greenish, I'm sorry, if you will.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. We tried different color combinations, and it was difficult to come up with one that was just absolutely pure. But the some of them do look a little bit on the olive side, but
yes,
they're evacuation routes nonetheless. Thank you.
Oh, also, people from Manatee, don't forget it's a good way to get down for Mother's Day brunch in Boca Grande at the hotel, which is quite an event. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. I just see the notation here on the bottom of the label. This project had been formerly known as the Englewood Interstate Connector, mm-hmm, and the board had decided that the appropriate name was the River Road Regional Interstate Connector. So will the Englewood nomenclature be going away, or is
We have to be very careful with that, because this has been a project of record for a long time, and it's been named the Englewood Interstate Connector since its inception, and now we're transitioning to a new name. So we want to make sure that all of our partners are aware that they are one and the same. We've talked with Florida DOT personnel about that issue and Federal Highway, and so everyone's clear now that the name of this project is being rebranded, if you will, as with a new name.
Right. So that transitional, we'll see both listed here and labeled here, and then as this
eventually
goes on,
over time, it'll okay. Yeah, the Englewood Interstate Connector will fade away. Thank you.
And thank you for the work on the evacuation routes.
You're welcome. Glad to do it.
Anything else for Mr. Mayo? Okay, Mr. Howe next.
Thank you, Chair and board members. Welcome to the July 27th, 2015 MPO board meeting. Chair Councilman Bennett and I have been attending several regional meetings here recently. One is the Chair's Coordinating Committee of West Central Florida, which is held in Tampa. That is the seven MPOs in the multi-county area of the Tampa Bay area that extends all the way from Sarasota up to basically Citrus now. Secondly, just this past week, Chair Councilman Bennett and I attended the statewide meeting of the 27 metropolitan planning organizations in the state in Orlando with the Metropolitan Planning Organization Advisory Council, and had an excellent meeting. I will defer to Councilman Bennett if he would like to make any comments regarding that meeting. Most notably, just for your information, because I know some of you and several of you have utilized over the years the services of the Metropolitan Planning Organization Advisory Committee, which is based out of Tallahassee, and that was Howard Glassman, was the executive director for years, great gentleman, who retired here within the last 6 months. They have, and we ratified at the meeting, the new executive director of the MPOAC, where all the 27 MPOs. Another wonderful gentleman, very articulate and intelligent, came from Federal Highway, Mr. Carl McKiska. So if you see that name, that's who he is now. He is the executive director of the MPOAC. After eight resolutions since 2008, Congress is now facing a termination of funding in the Federal Transportation Trust Fund this Friday. And you know it's serious when Congress was meeting on Sunday, and they met yesterday, and they met on Saturday, and they are trying to get their arms around what direction they want to head for a new transportation bill. And this has been going on, as I said, since about 2008 when the original six-year bill expired. What's on the table currently, and of course this is evolving, there'll probably be compromises this week, we certainly hope so that there is not an actual termination of federal funding, which has dire consequences for the certainty of projects that are programmed in our existing system and the future. That's the significance of federal funding, and FDOT has to, you know, rely upon that, you know, for making programming decisions. So that's the significance of why we are concerned about that. But in any event, what's on the table is we have a proposal by the Senate that is about $330 billion over the next 6 years. So it's a more comprehensive six-year bill, which was the tradition, you know, that was, you know, historically what had happened with the Federal Transportation Trust Fund. What's happened since 2008 is that Congress has been propping up the transportation funding in our nation with general fund revenues instead of utilizing the Transportation Trust Fund, which runs a deficit of about $20 billion each year because we haven't raised the federal gas tax of 18.4 cents a gallon since Ronald Reagan administration. In any event, so the Senate is proposing the six-year comprehensive bill. The House is proposing another resolution to extend it for about 5 months to the end of the year and buy some time to have more negotiations and discussion. So that's what's being debated this week. As I said, the actual last resolution expires this Friday, so stay tuned on that. You know, read your local papers and even the, you know, the news coverage, which is actually actually got this on their radar now. Yes, question.
Yes, Michael, thank you. I'd just like to state that the Florida League of Cities and the National League of Cities is lobbying extremely hard with the senators to continue down that path as the House of Leadership and to try to get the House of Representatives on board with that long-range planning. It's a start. This is, you know, in the time that I've been in office since 2006, this is the first I've seen a plan like this.
Well, and it's a solid plan in my opinion. It's, as I said, about $330 billion. I know that sounds like a tremendous amount of money, but when you spread it nationwide, and you look at the cost of transportation projects, it runs out quickly. But to give you an indication, the bill that was passed in 2003 was about $280 billion. So it is an increase of about $50 billion, which you know, certainly is reflective of the fact that, you know, it's 12 years later, and it should be higher, and you know, with the costs and inflationary factors. But anyways, thank you for that and the League of Cities work on that. And finally, I'll defer to Councilman Bennett. You have an announcement about officers and everything that you're going to comment on your report.
Yes.
But that's the end of my report. If you have any questions, please ask.
Any questions of Mr. Howe? Thank you. I will go on to my own report by commenting on another aspect of the CCC meetings and the MPOAC meetings. This is really exciting stuff, of course. The politics part of it, we could probably spend a couple of days discussing transportation bills and the way Congress deals with them, but that is not really what the worst part of it is. Obviously, if we're short on money, we have a great deal of difficulty in not only planning, but prioritizing dollars that aren't there. And that's the general concern that always comes up. However, there's an additional matter that I think is important for the entire board to be aware of. And that is, without a concerted, well-developed federal transportation funding policy, not just money attached, but a policy, the staff of the MPOs all over the country does not know which end is up in terms of standards that they must meet and goals that they have to comply with, because a great deal of both come down from the Federal Highway Department. Therefore, when you get into meetings in which staff executives discuss the subject of federal funding and even state funding, you get a lot of commentary on trying to develop a terminology for dealing with day-to-day work of transportation planning at the local level when you don't know whether that terminology is going to be in place in a month. And it is more than frustrating for staff, and we depend upon staff for a great deal of support in when we make our own policy decisions. So that goes on at every single one of these meetings, and it's on top of the table. It's not under the rug at all. And the discussions are interesting because they get into the factors that are involved in making policy and deciding how to prioritize the funding. But one of the results of the current limited federal plan has been a shift in focus on multimodal or non-surface transportation, and the bottom line of that has been a lot of focus on bike trails. And what is of interest, and over the summer maybe we can put together a package for the board for the next meeting, is the state of Florida is developing a really exciting cross-state and north-south state system of bike trails. It does not solve traffic congestion, but it does give more opportunities for recreation, for tourism, and for relief from congestion if you are bold and brave and healthy enough to take that other means of transportation. So those two subjects of bicycles and definitions are heavy in all of these meetings. It's quite interesting, but we all hope that the federal government will come up with something better than they have, sooner than they have. The other matter I would like to report on is that we are in a time of transition, and part of that is that I have determined I'm not going to run for office again, and that means that my term as councilman expires sometime in the middle of November. I have not checked precisely what that date is, and it partly depends on what the charter says in Venice. However, it does mean that I will not be able to be chair in December. That would leave Mr. Ruff chairing a meeting in which we normally elect officers, and that is quite awkward, to say the least. So what I'm going to suggest to this body, if there is no great objection, is that we have a election of officers in October so that the December meeting can go forward with a full slate of officers in place. I don't think you have a problem with that.
No, sir.
It now would give you all time to think about who you want to be your leadership going forward without making anything last minute. Is there any comment or discussion on this? If not, I will have staff make sure that that is on the October agenda and we can discuss the effective date of that, but it probably should be for the December meeting, so that meeting is not an awkward meeting. Yes, Ms. Yates.
You know, it makes perfect sense what you're saying, and certainly agree with that. Just from the bylaws perspective, do we need a motion to do that? To, you know, does this board need to take action?
I'd have to double check the actual wording of the bylaws, but we will do that and properly, propose the resolution.
We'll do something in September meeting. We'll have some formality.
Yeah, but good question. Yeah, good thought.
That way we don't have to ask our council to shoot from the hip or whatever other expression there is. But I definitely think we don't want to, well, you can go until your term ends by filling the spot because that's that's got too many problems. And technically, I cannot be a member of this board if I'm not an elected official. Yes, Mr. Younger.
I would say that we could just simplify this and make a motion to that effect right now and move on without worrying about anything else. There's certainly no harm in doing a motion of that nature, and I so make a motion that the elections be held early as suggested by the chairman.
Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second to have elections for officers of this board in October instead of December. Is there any further discussion? If not, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Then we can get the details of how we actually do that from council, if necessary. Oh, he already has the answer.
No, I don't. I simply would remind the chair that this is an action item that is covered by the citizen right to speak law. So before you vote on it, or in this case, after it, you should probably call to see if anybody, a member of the public, wishes to address the board about the action item.
That's fine. I will be happy to do that.
But no, assuming yeah. no citizen wants to, which yeah. what Commissioner Younger indicated is the best idea is just give the staff instruction now.
Thank you. Is there any member of the public here who wishes to question or comment on the action we have just taken? And if there is and you don't know what to say, you can come to our next meeting when you have it all figured out and say it then. So I think that covers the basis. Okay, now on that finishes my report if anybody has any questions of me. The consent section, we have an additional item that is on a separate sheet. I do not think it is of moment such that it needs to be pulled and voted on separately. There were some scrivener's errors in the minutes, which I've advised staff of. I don't think that requires that to be pulled. Does anybody want to pull anything out of the consent section? Yes, Ms. Chapman.
On item 3, there's just one minor correction, I think. And that is on page 8, when it's regular member agencies, it says the City of Sarasota Planning and Zoning Division. It's called Neighborhood and Development Services.
That can be done by a scrivener's error charge. Yes?
On item 7-1, I don't know if this was part of the errors you mentioned, but on page 2 of 8, there where Chair Bennett welcomed and you named the folks, Ms. Alpert, it states that it's Sarasota County and it should be the City of Sarasota.
Oh, I didn't catch that. Thank you, Ms. Mason. Anything else? Those are all not requiring to be pulled. Yes, Mayor.
Yes, mine's just a minor thing, such as Commissioner Chapman. Page 3 of item 7, number 2 amendments to the CAC. On page 3, it should be permission to file. Just minor.
Any others? Linda, you had another one.
Yes, on item number 3, item number 2 for the CAC bylaws on page 7. Just a minor scrivener's. It should be the meeting date of July 27th. It currently says June. So just a minor.
Good. Yes, Betsy.
And I assume this is a scrivener's error you caught, but in the minutes it says that the received a report from Sarasota County Area Transit and says SCAT. That's
yeah, well,
one that
I
was
got.
Caught.
That's, okay, it
should
that's
be managed.
One I got.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else? I might mention that this should not be criticism of staff. As you can see, we're covering an awful lot of turf lately. And we also have some changes in board members and some substitutes, so it's a cute trick to get it all right at once. Is anybody interested in pulling any of these items after these minor changes? Mr. Howe, you had a comment?
I did, and just to culminate the comments, and I appreciate all your serious consideration of these items, but I received a call earlier, an email from Vice Mayor Moore of the City of Northport regarding the agenda, because the agenda references TAC under lost my agenda sheet. Under Roman numeral 7 on your agenda, number 2, it references the CAC in the caption, and then down in the subscript it says TAC. Should be CAC, just for the record. Thank you, sir.
Anything else? I'm also pleased to see everybody's read this stuff. That's terrific. Either that
very
or you're
impressive.
Doing it fast right now.
Yeah, stop doing that.
Yes, Mayor.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second. Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Any further discussion? All those in favor of approving the consent items, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Thank you. Next, Mr. Mayholz. You are up again. Oh, we've got a slideshow here. Good.
Good morning again, everyone. Mike Mayholz, planner at MPO staff. this morning, we're bringing to you the end result of about the last 5 months of work that we've been doing on our long-range transportation plan, working with our steering committee and the technical advisory committee. We've gone through a number of iterations of the travel forecast model, and what we have for you this morning is what's called our needs plan. This is our, if you will, best guess at what we can move forward with in terms of for the long-range transportation plan, what would become the financially feasible plan. I'd like to point out to you that on this map, it gets a little confusing at times, and Mr. Lepp here momentarily will go into it in greater detail. But usually when people see this map, they say, well, such and such a road is missing. It's not on here, and it's needed. If the project that you're thinking about is under construction or has construction funds scheduled for it within the next 5 years, it's not going to show up on the needs plan because it's basically covered. It's already set up for construction funds. So these needs are for 5 years from now and beyond. Things that are, as I said, things that are currently under construction or about to be constructed won't show up on this needs plan. But at this point in time in the long-range transportation plan process of the update, where we're at, we have finished our round of focus groups. We're all done with those. We're still continuing to take public comment on issues as they come up. Our website is still active for the long-range plan. And we will be bringing to you in September the first draft of the financially feasible plan, which will be based on this long-range plan. So what we'd ask you today is to approve us moving forward, use this plan to develop the financially feasible plan. Right now I'd like to turn over to Nick to go through it and go into greater detail about those things.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Mike. Good morning. Nick Lepp from Renaissance Planning Group. As Mike said, this is a accumulation of the past 5 months of the technical analysis, the behind-the-scenes work to start developing the long-range plan. We are getting close. This will establish itself as the framework or foundation for developing the financially feasible component of the plan. These are all those projects that we will start pulling from. And as Mike said, everything after what's already been approved in your transportation improvement plan. The adopted TIP goes into the year 2019. So we're looking for those next round of projects to go into the improvement plan for 2020 to 2025, the next five-year block after that, and so on. So this will establish itself as those list of projects that we'll pull from that could go into the plan next. It's all based on, like Mike said, committed projects. So if it's committed, it's what's next, what needs to come afterwards. If there is only a certain phase committed, say for right-of-way or the PD&E, this plan takes that into the next stages. This is, again, a constrained needs plan for those that were involved in the 2030 or 2035 long-range plan, where we don't just get the red out. We don't look at a project or put a needs plan project in there wherever there is forecasted congestion. We take into account areas that are physically policy or financially constrained where we can't widen those. So we can have a more focused plan and vision on what we can do about the transportation 20 years down the road or in 2040. We've developed five alternatives, and unlike most alternative testing, we didn't just put the kitchen sink in. We tried to test these incrementally, because as I said before in these presentations, our focus is what's next. So we really want to figure out what are those next projects in the next five-year block that we need to move forward with. So we tested these projects individually to see which one is really needed first. And as we start going through the prioritization and this next round before we come back to you with financially feasible draft results, that'll take into account the year of need along with financial feasibility and what might have some partial funding to it. The map that we have here are those committed projects that Mike was talking about. These are the projects that have funding, construction funding by 2020. So we do not need to look for additional funding for the next round of projects in the long-range plan. And down in Sarasota, the same projects also. So these projects, we don't need to find additional funding. We're assuming that they will be committed and constructed by the year 2020. Going into the needs plan, this is where we started taking into account the comprehensive plans, local studies, transportation modeling, and the comments and perceptions coming from our long-range planning committee that helped develop this plan into, you know, what's next? What do we really need to look at as our transportation vision and framework to start building on the financially feasible plan? You can see in there also we have a section highlighted for that central Manatee alternatives analysis. Understanding that there will be projects coming forward in the future, but we don't know specifically what they are, but we want to make sure that the long-range plan is set up to easily move those into and get funding. Down in Sarasota County, both the central and then down the south, you can see River Road or the River Road Interstate Connector is now included and is highlighted in the long-range plan. We also have I-75, the ultimate I-75 project included, because we wanted to make sure that when we were developing the plan, we weren't duplicating efforts and trying to solve a problem that might be solved with that. Though we know it's not financially feasible just yet, we wanted to establish what projects are needed to help support that project or help facilitate that regional access. Also within the plan, we're developing a bicycle pedestrian component of it. We're utilizing the bicycle pedestrian master plan that was adopted about a year ago. We've made some updates based on comments from the boards and the committees to make sure that we've accurately reflected what's been constructed and what's needed. We'll be taking those top priorities forward using the funding that's available to help implement some of these multimodal projects. Went a little too fast. And then with transit, we've taken into account both the Manatee County Area Transit and Sarasota County Area Transit development plans for all those projects that they have assumed could be in by the year 2020. We've carried those over into the long-range plan, but which I'll go into in more detail later in a presentation with an update of our financial resources. This is the transportation vision or framework that we're going to be looking to pull projects from, but we don't have any funding right now available to really start implementing some or all of these projects. So what's next? We're going to start looking at that existing and planned committed funding. the year of need to ultimately develop that draft financially feasible list in those five-year increments of what's next, what needs to come in that 2030 to 2035 time frame, and then what are those remaining projects that we might think could be funded by 2040 but are still out there a little ways. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any? Yes, Betsy.
Yeah, thank you. I do have some questions about the 2040 roadway needs plan. One of them, 15th Street, is not on there at all. What is the plan for that?
That was one of the corrections that were made based on the citizens and the technical advisory committees. It was included in the bicycle pedestrian because it's a multimodal project, but we have now also included it in the roadway projects on the map here in the updated maps to make sure that it's consistent, that it's still a transportation complete street project, but it's not a widening project. So we have made that correction in the map.
Okay, and then in Northwest Manatee County, Bradenton, actually, there is a large area of land that is designated for 9 units per acre, and that is coming to the County Commission for consideration, and I don't see any new roads proposed in that area. Has there been any discussion about that?
We have included the forecasted land use, but we do not have any improvements identified in that area due to some constraints on Manatee Ave. And then there are some committed projects that were accounted for. Oh, it's going a little slow. Which is the 75th Street and El Conquistador. So those improvements that were assumed as committed helped to alleviate some of that, but those were the only improvements in the area beyond the constraints that we had for the needs.
Well, I wonder about that. The other area that I wonder about is in the 2040 plan, there's no new transit in the parish area at all. I mean, there's no consideration of any extension of transit out to that area in the 2040 plan. That sounds, given the proposed development that's on the books and given the comprehensive plan designation, I mean, that doesn't seem to make a lot of sense to me either.
Okay. Well, that's something that we can look into and adding as a placeholder and a framework to pull projects from.
Okay. I'm going to go to this side and then I'll come back to you. Yes, Ms. Yates.
Okay. In looking at the South Sarasota County, so specific to the Northport area, and maybe my question is answered by the explanation Mr. Mayholtz gave as far as the projects, but I wanted to say it here so that I'm not just assuming. Northport is experiencing quite a bit of growth, and they will be definitely moving forward, as we've seen in previous studies. And so right now at our staff level, I mean, there's conversations going on about alternatives and basically relieving some of the congestion. I know with accidents on Interstate 75, our city was basically on lockdown. I mean, it was shut down. And so one of those areas in particular is the Price Boulevard that basically runs to the Charlotte County line, and looking at opportunity for connectivity to River Road. So there's many, many conversations I do know that has to be had with various jurisdictions involved with that. But is there no opportunity to show it on a needs plan, even though we're not yet to the formulated identification of it? I mean, I'm not sure what stage a need has to be in order to make it on here.
I'll let Nick finish it up, but my initial comment is consistency with local comprehensive plans, and that there's a clear inconsistency between we know that Sarasota County does not want a facility through there. It's not in their future comprehensive plan. So that would be the first step in the process, is to for the two communities to jointly agree on a comprehensive plan for a facility through that area. And then the other thing that makes it almost a constraining factor is the environmental issues, that the cost of mitigation to put a facility across the river there would be very difficult. So those are some of the two primarily the two factors that went into us not showing a need there, were those constraining factors of the inconsistency in the comp plans and the environment.
So basically, it is really where we have to get through the complexities of it to iron out all of those things. I know the extension of Toledo Blade to 72 was an issue that has come up several times as far as working.
Similar issues with constraints.
But there is an opportunity once we get there, once we get to that point, that this 2040 plan can be appropriately amended or added to.
Oh, yeah, well, that's what we do it every 5 years.
Yes.
Over the next 5 years, there may be changes in comp plans, et cetera, and then
right.
those will be reflected in the.
Okay. Well, I just wanted to air the conversation here, just so that, you know, everybody is aware that we in the city of Northport are trying to come up with some solutions for what's foreseen and yet to come. I want to flip to the bike and pedestrian.
Certainly.
In regards to this one, I was surprised to not see some of the needs in the city of Northport in particular, because there are certain gaps when we look at the blue lines that are on here, and I guess that's what's existing, and there's some gaps in there.
Yes.
So, for example, Toledo Blade running up to the county line there of unincorporated area, there's a little... just a little gap that's missing that will connect and kind of bring everything else together. So that's an area that certainly I would hope to see in the needs plan that could be shown appropriately. And then there's a gap between, it looks like, Chamberlain and Toledo Blade. Then there's also the gap that would be, not sure on here, but I think it's Sumter Boulevard. Just again, closing those holes that are there.
Certainly, that's definitely a correction that we could make on the maps.
Okay, and then as far as the trailways, the city of Northport has worked for decades in regards to a trailway from the Myakkahatchee Creek that goes down toward 41, and that's been in the plans, it's even budgeted in our CIP as we go along. That's not reflected on here in green as far as trails. So I don't know if there's an opportunity to, it would definitely connect to that Carlton-Myakka trailway.
Is it you have construction money committed to it over the next 5 years? Is that perhaps why?
We're in the process of acquisition of some of the properties along that. But I do know that the county right now and the city have a joint agreement where we're putting a pedestrian bridge that actually goes from the Myakkahatchee Creek to over to the Carlton. So I think it's Carlton where it's there per.
Can we next?
Certainly.
Yeah, just for that connectivity again.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yeah, I might comment at this point before I go to Ms. Bow that I have noticed the confusion between the two Myakkahatchee Creek crossings in Northport. They're separate things. One goes along with 41 and the other goes inland. And that inland one is the big trail that's coming from the Legacy Trail and goes all the way into Northport. So we're going to make sure we keep them separate.
Right.
And otherwise, one's going to be left out. Yes, Ms. Well, Bowen.
Okay.
Yeah. I just had one other thing.
Okay. I'll come back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, in looking at the 2040 plan, I'm glad to see State Road 70 from Lorain on the 2040. What concerns me, and I know I'm new to the MPO, but we're having problems on that road as we speak. We're about to, you know, see growth there at Lorain and State Road 70, probably over 10,000 homes. You know, there's already so much traffic going on State Road 70, trying to get down to, as I said earlier, Verna Bethany, to get over to Sarasota. So we're already having traffic issues on that road. So to think of it not being widened until 2040 is just not going to work. And I'm assuming, did I hear that it does come up every 5 years when we can change it, and that's good. But my concern is it probably needs to be looked at today. So, you know, to wait 5 years or 2040 is just not going to work. So, any suggestions?
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, Florida Department of Transportation is currently working on a PD&E for that segment, actually from Lorain, I believe, eastward to Myakka City.
Right.
The entire length. Out of that will come an evaluation that will say, this is what we need to widen, and then from that point, you can set up a time frame. We do have it identified as a need in our plan.
Correct. It's identified
so
as
we'll wait for the results of the PD&E to tell us exactly what the parameters of the roadway will be.
That was my next question, Mike.
What's the time frame on the PD&E?
On the PD&E. What's the time?
It's in the next couple of years.
Okay. Okay. So it will be addressed, I think. We have it in our long-range plan as a need, but I think there are things going on in current time that are addressed.
There's
some
so much growth going on there as we speak.
But we can't commit any money to it immediately because we don't know exactly what's needed, and that'll come out of the PD&E.
Okay, thank you.
I'll come back to you. I'm going to go back to this side again, and I'll be right over there.
Okay.
That's it?
No, I thought you wanted to finish up first.
Okay. So going back to the pedestrian and the bike, we're experiencing in the city of Northport a substantial amount of growth on our eastern side from Toledo Blade heading towards the Charlotte County. And so looking at the map here as far as the bike and pedestrian, it just dead ends sort of at the Toledo Blade area. And so I don't know if there's been conversation or looking at extending to at least Atwater, which is a more concentrated area of the city that just doesn't seem to appear on the maps in some of the future planning. So from Toledo Blade to Atwater, there's just nothing shown, and I really would appreciate consideration of the bike and the pedestrian to be looked at as a need perspective. And along those lines, the same would be the case on the transit. So again, it just dead ends there at Toledo Blade. And I just would really, really suggest that our growth is really now picking up, on that eastern side, and to please consider, some of that transit service toward the Atwater, towards that roadway.
Okay. All right. Mr. Chairman, can I go back to Ms. Baugh's comment? I was just handed the Transportation Improvement Program that was just adopted by this board in June, I believe.
Right.
There is PD&E funds available for State Road 70, Lorain Road to Singletary Road in fiscal year 16-17. So it's coming up rather quickly.
And it'll take approximately 2 years for that PD&E, correct? Thereabouts?
Yeah, I would think so. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But they'll start with that small segment first, and that's probably the more immediate need.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
Betsy?
On the 2040 needs bicycle pedestrian network on Upper Manatee River Road, the bridge does have a bike lane. There's a bike lane on Lakewood Ranch Boulevard, but to my knowledge, there's no funding for a bike lane on the section Upper Manatee River Road connected to the bridge. So it's definitely a need.
Okay.
And I know you said that if it's funded, it wouldn't show up, but there should be some connection, because there's existing trails on this map, so there should be a connection. I mean, that's going to be a pretty important bike connection there, so something should be shown, I think, on this.
We'll look for the consistency between the improvement and the bike ped, because that could also reflect the Northport comment, especially with Price Boulevard. It will include multimodal improvements, so we'll look at that consistency. Thank you.
Okay.
And I was talking about Fort Hamer Road.
Upper Manatee to Fort.
Make sure it was clear.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Patrick.
Thank you, Chair Bennett. As an observation to Commissioner Abban's comments, that I know that in my first year in office in 2006, I attended a transportation charrette where I proposed the third bridge across the Manatee River, and I'm just happy that 9 years later, I finally see a line on a map I think this is a game of patience and persistence that now I need to make that line a solid line,
and then find the funding and the permits and...
You're talking about that, Tim?
Third bridge.
No, good.
No, he's talking about the river, Manatee River.
Oh, no.
Any more comments or questions? I'd like to add at this point that this is precisely why we do this, to get comments like this. And you'll find that there are gaps and holes, partly because things are funded or not funded, and some are financially feasible and some aren't, and those change. I do hear something that we probably haven't done, which is eventually a master map that color codes the rankings of impossible to next week. But we can deal with that as time moves on. It's a continuing process. It's not perfect. But the reason we're here is because we need the input from all of you, whether it's municipal or county, and you're probably going to want to drill down to your staff engineers to make sure that you get everything into the MPO that you want to see somewhere. It may not be at the top of the list. It may be one of those red items at the end, but we want to get as much in this as we possibly can. Thank you. Now, Mr. Mahos, you would like a motion here to approve going forward with what you have?
Yes, sir.
Comments?
And to the comments that you just made, I'd like to say, you know, that the process we're going through, this particular needs map that you're looking at, especially the bicycle pedestrian maps, are very complicated. It's been reviewed by the Bicycle Pedestrian Committee. It's been reviewed by the Long Range Steering Plan Committee. It's been reviewed by the Technical Advisory Committee and the Citizens Advisory Committee. And we're still finding little pieces that get missed as with each review. So your input is certainly appreciated very much. We'll make sure that all the notations that you gave us here today get included, and we'll move forward from there. But Wes, we are requesting, seeking a motion for you to adopt this needs plan and let us move forward into our next phase for financial feasibility.
May I have a motion?
Move to approve the long-range transportation plan.
Second.
Transportation
needs plan. Any further discussion? Yes, Linda.
Yeah, I just want to re-emphasize, so you're moving it with staff taking consideration all of the discussion that we've had. Yes. So the final one might reflect that.
Yes, and will. If you would get the motion, please refer to it as the 2040 needs plan.
So moved.
Transportation needs plan.
So moved.
We'll take that as the original motion.
Yes.
With your second.
Yes.
Correct?
Correct.
Okay. Yes, Betsy.
Just a comment. And, you know, I recognize, as with the funding, we do the best we can with projections and everything, but how often do we revisit this plan?
The long-range transportation plan? Every 5 years.
Okay.
Every 5 years. So this
will be, things change.
Things change.
And we need to be able to react to those changes.
Yeah. Not only do they change, but they're constantly changing.
It's a real moving target.
Any further discussion? This motion is to adopt the plans with the commentary that we've had. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Thank you, Mr. Mahos.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Keep up the good planning work. Next, Mr. Howe, signage. Goodness.
Thank you, Chair. This is a follow-up to this board's action here about 2 months ago, two meetings ago. Wherein we were discussing the Nathan Benderson Park and the rowing championship that's going to be held there. And there was a request made regarding signage on Interstate 75. And there's a strict policy, as there should be, on Interstate 75 regarding signage and, not having a proliferation of signs that makes things look good. Poor. Attached in your packet is from Chair Carolyn Mason of Sarasota County, a request letter that she has made to this MPO to offer a letter of support for signage on Interstate 75 as expressed in the letter. And We have drafted that letter in response to Chair Mason, and would ask for your consideration of that. If there's any questions, we have FDOT here regarding the process. It's a great plan, and the World Championship is going to be in 2017. It's a very prestigious event, very exciting for our area, and will bring a lot of visitors and tourists to our area. So we want them to know where they're going, and that's the bottom line.
Carolyn, do you have any comment on your letter?
No,
it's pretty good, right the way
it
is.
I thought it was pretty.
Any further discussion on the subject before we have a motion? I have a motion to
over here
approve the letter.
So moved.
So moved.
Second. Down here, any further discussion on that? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. So carried.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
The next item has Mr. Howe presenting it. Well, you may, but I have to comment at some point. So.
Well, no, I'm simply going to introduce it that there was a committee formed to execute or negotiate an employment agreement with the new executive director, which you had made action on. And Chair Bennett, you were the chair of that along with several of the others. We have, as we know, Robert Eschenfelder, the senior guru attorney of Manatee County. What's your title again?
Chief assistant.
Senior what?
Chief assistant.
Chief assistant. Man, that's a mouthful, I tell you.
Important person.
Yeah, important person of Manatee County Legal Counsel. But no, seriously, Rob has been giving us legal counsel for 15 years, and we're very fortunate to have him. But we'll let Rob and Chair Bennett take this issue up.
Okay, the committee was myself and Ms. Yates substituting for Ms. Robinson, who couldn't make it, Mr. Ruff, and Mayor Groover Bryant. And it was a pretty good hash out of the existing agreement and the changes from Mr. Howe's position. Frankly, Mr. Hutchinson got hit a little bit, but I think it was the sense of the committee that the end result gave him a good increase from where he is and allows him to go forward without a huge amount of red tape. And in particular, we discussed the whole concept of measuring performance. It's something, you know, that the state legislature in Tallahassee just loves. They have all these tests and exams and standards and everything, and they change them every couple of years, and it's really good fun and games, and we wanted to avoid that. One of the things we had was a set of guidelines from other jurisdictions that if they did not glaze your eyes over, would give you a migraine. And we wanted to avoid that. So I will let our counsel explain what I call a trigger mechanism that we have put into this contract that goes along with the fact that there is to be a performance standard, that is, that the executive performs well. And the committee agreed to let me meet with staff, all staff, next month in order to find out the kinds of things that they need to do in terms of meeting deadlines and getting money presented to the board. Things like that, that we can use to boil down into some simple measurements. Because the members of the committee felt, and I think the board will concur, that we as a board are not close enough to the day-to-day operations of staff, which are extensive and relate to innumerable statutes and regulations, for us to really make the kind of judgment that you would if you were head of personnel in your own Human Resources Department. Therefore, we want to have something that's much more functional and relates to things that we can all grab a hold of when we see them or when we don't see them. Mr. Eschenfelder, if you would explain the July 1st concept, I think I'll call it.
Thank you.
Or is it June 1st, I don't, whatever the date is.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the board. I promised Ms. Lockwood I would be done in 3 minutes. I'm not entirely sure if I can do that. But I do want to start off just by saying for the whole board, since y'all were not present for the meeting of your subcommittee, that it was quite impressive. I think that the committee took great pleasure in noting that they happen to all be municipal officers as opposed to county officers, and that's why the meeting was so productive. But be that as it may, I do want to assure you all that that your subcommittee did do a really great job. They all four participated vigorously. The director, executive director, designee did propose an initial contract, and rather than just roll over and accept that contract, the subcommittee did have vigorous discussion with David, and many compromises were made, and I think that they were good. The model is going to be a 3-year model, as that seems to have worked with our executive directors here. The ability to terminate the employee who works at your will and pleasure, of course, is roughly the same, that you know there's either a cause or a no cause that this board can make. And so really turning to the biggest change, if you will, that the chair indicated in the compensation is that at the last meeting, this body wanted to have some opportunity to participate in the assessment of the performance of the executive director. And so I think the thought coming out of last meeting was that what would come back this meeting would be two things, an employment contract and an evaluation tool. But as the chair indicated, we gathered together a variety of evaluation tools and shared with the subcommittee. And I think it kind of became apparent to the subcommittee that the whole concept of exactly how this governing board would evaluate its executive director bears more discussion and so forth. And so the subcommittee elected to meet in the future on that and authorized the chair to have individual meetings with staff, as he indicated. But we do need to have a contract, and so what you see on page 4 is that David will be started off effective September 1 with a $125,000 salary. And then as you step through in section 5B and 5C, prior to July 1 of every year, this board has the opportunity to make a vote that the executive director has not been performing in a satisfactory manner, to whatever measure you all feel that is, and that's subject to further discussion with the subcommittee. But it can be anything. It's totally up to you whether he was performing satisfactorily in that previous year. If you do not take such a vote by July 1, then there will be an automatic 5% increase, and so in the following year he would step up to 131,250. You would have that then same opportunity in the third year, and so he would, if you do not take that vote, he would step up to 137,812.50, presuming he didn't get poorly evaluated in the prior year, at which point he would only step up to 131,250. So it's pretty self-explanatory how it works. There's a trigger, and it's fair to your executive director, who should feel that he's performing well, as long as he doesn't hear from you that he's not performing well. And certainly it allows you all, though, to, on an annual basis, as a group, decide, look, you know, David, you're not addressing some things that we need you to address, and hopefully you would communicate those with him. As Mr. Howe did, David negotiated an additional annual compensation into a deferred retirement fund or funds of his choosing. That contribution starts in the first year at $10,000, and then it will continue in $10,000 in the second and third years. However, again, using the same trigger mechanism of a vote before July 1, he would receive an additional $1,000 in the second year and an additional $2,000 in the third year. So again, assuming that you are pleased with his work for the 3 years, it would be $10,000, $11,000, and $12,000, and then that would be the end of that term. The agreement, as per the request of this body, does contain language, as it did with Mr. Howell, that y'all may develop in the future an evaluation tool, a written evaluation tool, and establish goals for your executive director, and your executive director would be subject to those. I do want to just make a special note that while your subcommittee did work hard, I do want to especially commend Commissioner Yates, who is about the best non-lawyer contract lawyer that y'all have here. She really honed in on a lot of things, and the document reads all the more perfectly because of her individual efforts, and so I did want to indicate that as well. I know she also was one of the ones that bargained very hard for you all monetarily, so that is to be commended as well. With that, I will see if there's any questions from the board.
Any questions or comments? Yes, Vanessa.
I just have one. Page two, termination by the board, and it talks about number three, at least 11 members of the board. Why is it based 11 members of the board instead of a majority of the board, a simple majority?
In Mr. Howe's agreement, it did also contain a supermajority. The only change here is that the numbers went up to reflect the numbers that having gone up on this body. It is the will of this body if it wants to be by a simple majority. It's a policy decision. Your subcommittee did not flag that as a problem, and so that's the way it has been drafted.
Mm. Find that odd.
Anything further on that?
No, sir.
Yes. Betsy?
Okay. I just wondered, and I did not do any substantial research, so I'll admit this. In terms of comparison of salaries for MPO directors, was any of that done? Was there any look at what is the feel generally?
Yes, ma'am. We acquired and provided to the subcommittee a very good compendium, I think, of all of the executive directors in Florida, if I'm not mistaken, one of whom, interestingly, informed me that he did not wish to provide his contract, and if he did, he would redact his salary. At which point I reminded him that there's a thing called the public records law, and I was shocked, you know, and it was a large MPO on the other coast, who shall remain nameless, and so but we did acquire them all, and so you see some that are quite higher than this, you see a few that are lower than this, but I think, Mr. Chair, this falls into the mid to low range, is my recollection of the chart.
Let's put it this way, it gives Dave a little room to move, basically. But we had a list of everybody, and the surprise was the Lee County executive was really, really underpaid, and that's a very large county, but nobody could explain that. Yes?
Mr. Chair, can I ask how many years Mr. Howell was with the organization?
Since 2002, and executive director since 2005. So 10 years as executive.
Okay. And when did the supermajority change? Was that from day one on your contract?
It was on day one when I had initiated with Rob's help in 2005 my initial contract or agreement.
Mr. Brook, if I could speak to that, because I also was counsel during the time of Mike Guy, who was the prior executive director, mm-hmm. and my recollection is that there was a concern about one side of the university line, you know, lining up against the executive director versus the other side of the line, and so requiring some votes from both sides of that divide, I think, is one of the logical reasons why it wasn't a simple majority.
This board is made up of representatives of all either appointed or elected bodies, correct?
That's correct.
So they have to attend, yeah. Right? So there's never there's never a lack of people here, is my point. You're not looking for a quorum issue or anything like that?
No, sir.
Not so far.
It's a political issue.
Right.
That a majority of the entities that make up the membership buy into removing him.
So the supermajority was strictly to try to keep representation? Because supermajorities, to me, usually come into play when there has been some performance already established, and then you're trying to avoid politics making decisions, and it's more about policy. So I'm a little confused by the supermajority as a rule. I think there's 18 members here. Is that correct?
17. Mr. Barris, let me see what's down this side of the table, if anything. Yeah, Patrick.
Thank you. As part of the committee, I can tell you that we did compare other salaries. We also compared them with the size that they represented, you know, and I believe that we were. Pretty effective in analyzing, you know, apples to apples. I can tell you that Commissioner Yates is an extremely hard negotiator, and every figure that you're looking at and every percentage that you're looking at is less than where we started.
I have no questions about the compensation. My question is strictly the cause and the lack of cause for termination and that you're requiring a supermajority in order to compensate. I think the compensation is the contract in and of itself is fine. It's strictly the supermajority issue that gives me concern. But if the subcommittee took that, did the subcommittee take that in consideration from other MPO boards across the state? Do they have similar conditions?
That's a good question.
I don't know that, but I could comment that in Venice anyway, and I'm not sure about the other municipalities. Our city manager can be terminated only on a supermajority because it's a high-profile a position, and in many cases, it's a very tough job to be a city manager in the state of Florida. There are some city managers who have unbelievably long terms, but many don't. I don't think the MPO executives have quite that exposure, but they very well could, and I think that's probably the basis underneath for a supermajority. Yes, Mr.
Young. I'm not necessarily opposed to a supermajority, but I do have concerns about a supermajority. Normally, when somebody loses the confidence of over 50% of a body, they're pretty much a lame duck at that point anyway. It's difficult to continue to survive after you've lost the majority. So usually it's just a matter of time. And not too sure, you know, we're talking about 18 people, so you're talking about 9 being a 50% level. So are we really talking about a supermajority here? It's going to take 10 to do it anyway. Yeah, so that sounds like it's really a majority. It's not a supermajority, as long as the board's 18 people. So you've got to have the 9 plus 1. So this is not a supermajority.
Well, it
was 11. Yes, Mr. Barris.
If I may add, in the contract, it specifically says 11.
Right.
Okay. So, you know, let's say that there's an issue comes up and you have a board meeting and somebody's absent for illness or on vacation or something else, then all of a sudden you have an issue come up and you can't take action because it says 11 in the contract.
I think 11, 10. I would be more comfortable with just a majority of those voting.
The way we can deal with this is, if we want, I'll get you, Patrick, in just a minute, we can have an amendment to deal with just that issue if we want to do that.
I think if a member wishes to make a motion, you could just make a motion to approve the agreement with the instruction that in every place where it mentions the 11 members to simply change the language to requiring a simple majority vote. Yeah. That's easy enough to do.
Okay, yes, Mr. Rowe.
The other point that was discussed on this matter, I can see the point of changing it from supermajority, from a number to the term. But we did discuss that that the salary increase of 5% will be a performance evaluation, and that the executive director will know if he's in trouble if he receives poor valuations and no increases. That will be a heads up that you know, things are not going well.
Any further discussion?
Mr. Chair,
yeah.
I'm going to go ahead and make the motion to change supermajority to simple majority.
Yes, would you like to make that a broader motion as the attorney has suggested, so that you approve the contract with that, or you just want to do that right now?
Rob, maybe you might want to help with that to make sure it's
well, I believe
covered.
The intended motion is to approve the contract as presented, with the exception that in the termination sections 1A and B, that where the vote currently reads the vote of at least 11 members of the board, that would be changed to the vote of a simple majority of members of the board.
You like
second.
That?
Yes.
That's what you said?
Yes,
okay.
Sir. So moved.
Second.
Good. Mr. Younger?
Second.
Second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? So carried. Thank you. And David, congratulations.
Yay, David.
Yay. Welcome. Formal welcome. Okay, we're back to Mr. Mayholes. Looks like the same thing, but it really isn't.
No,
right?
It's not. This is the first cup of coffee of the morning. Eye opener, if you will. There'll be no action required on this. This is simply a presentation to you of our financial resources that we will have available to work with as we develop our financially feasible plan. And I mentioned earlier, we'll be coming forward with that to you at your September meeting. We'll bring you a draft for you to review and get comments on, et cetera. So between now and then, we've got a lot of number crunching to do. And this is the document that we'll use. This is where we'll get those numbers from. This is a revenue projection provided to us by Florida Department of Transportation as to what we can anticipate having available to us over the next 20 to 25 years. It shows overall less money than we had the last time, which is not good news. So we're going to have some tough choices to make. There's not a lot of money to work with, but I think we can come up with a good plan and do some really difficult project prioritization so that the projects reflect your wishes and the ones that essentially needed the most, where we can use the money most effectively. So at this point, I'll turn it back over to Nick and let him continue with his presentation. Go ahead, Nick.
Thanks, Mike. Again, Nick Lepp with Renaissance Planning Group. This is for information. This is what we're going to be working with to develop those projects and financially feasible plan that I just presented from that needs list earlier. This is the pot of money that we have in different categories that can be used towards different projects. The first one I'm going to explain are the other arterials or right-of-way funds. These funds are used for the state system or the regionally significant roadway network to widen and expand those roadways. Comparing this against the 2035 long-range plan, we have about 1% less, a little less money over that time, but we will be using this to help fund projects like the 15th Street project, Mox and Wallow, Honoré. These are the projects that it started with, and then also the Venice Bypass is where it was used. We'll be using this pot of funds for those other major roadways for widening, as I have identified in the needs list. Going through the prioritization, we haven't determined which ones can we fund just yet, but based on the adopted priorities, it will be projects like finishing up 15th Street, the River Road Connector, and then possibly some other major regional facilities. The second pot of funding is our transportation management area funds, or our TMA funds. These are our flexible urban funds, where we have used those for the congestion management program and the multimodal emphasis corridor. We're forecasting that it's going to be about 30% less than the last long-range plan, but we're still looking to continue those programs and focus on multimodal and urban accessibility by continuing these programs with this pot of funds. Comparing the enhancement funds, these were some flexible multimodal funds from the last long-range plan. Those have now changed with the legislation to the transportation alternative funds. We are forecasting more money, but in comparison to the other pots, it's still not one of the largest funding sources, but we're going to be looking to use those for multimodal improvements off of the multimodal emphasis corridor. So that could include bike and trails that are outside of that 41, but then also maybe some transit circulators or other opportunities. We're going to be looking at that as we go through the financially feasible plan. And then last but not least, the transit funds. These are the forecasted from what we'll be receiving, but what we've estimated is that this will just be enough to maintain the current system. We do not have any other revenue source besides those transportation alternatives to expand or continue any of the projects that we've identified in the needs. The last meeting, we looked to get a little policy direction on how we were going to start establishing the financially feasible plan after a little bit of a conversation and then going through the last policies and continuing with the last long-range plan. We're following these general guidelines as we develop the first draft that will come to you in September, where we're going to use those other arterial and construction funds. We're going to allocate those to that regional roadway network, and it just out of coincidence, Mike provided you with that map. So that will be the focus of that pot of money. The non-regional roads, so anything off of that, will use local funding sources. So we'll try to utilize local impact fees, mobility fees, or other sources to help complete those projects so the plans are consistent with the comprehensive plans in your local planning. The transportation management area funds, those TMA flexible funds, they'll continue to go towards the congestion management system and the multimodal emphasis corridor to allow those project expansions. And then the transportation alternatives will fund all multimodal projects not in the multimodal emphasis corridor. So it could be some of those other trails just outside of that corridor. And then we'll continue to look for opportunities to expand transit, but right now, based on our forecast, we don't have anything that could expand transit. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
You would like us to approve that policy, but there's not much wiggle room there, is there?
No, this is not really policy, more direction as we establish the first draft. This is not set in stone. It's just our way of coming to you in September, and then we can start making modifications based on some other analysis and priorities as we go forward. But this was our way to come up with the first thing to stick on the wall.
And it's possible you might have additional information from Washington in September. It's also possible you may not.
Exactly, and there could be some opportunities to use local funds in conjunction with the federal and state. This was just our way to keep things very simple and siloed as we go forward, but then we have those opportunities to move things around to really balance that financially feasible plan and get the most out of it that we can.
Yes, Betsy?
So are you going to go through the rest of the report, the revenue projections part, or are we supposed to ask questions on that now?
Oh, you can ask questions on that now. Okay. Yeah, I've only highlighted the federal and state and the money that we actually can allocate for the financially feasible plan, though in the report itself, we have estimated those local revenue sources just so we can make sure that our plan is consistent with the comprehensive plan and we're not shortchanging of the projects that we're including in it. So there could be a possibility for those projects to come in, but we don't have the authority to prioritize those. That's for the local governments.
Okay, well, then a couple things. So are these revenue projections, and when you say we're going to have more money in a certain pot, is that based on MAP 21, which, as we said, We don't know what's going to happen with that. We know something's going to happen because it's going to expire, right?
Correct. This is these are the assumptions that we're going forward with for this plan, though we don't know what could change, but they're the revenue forecast that all the MPOs are using to develop their long-range plans. So we're all consistent. Now, if those numbers do change, that's unfortunately why we have to do amendments occasionally or to verify. But these are for the funds that are from 2020 on.
Okay. And on table one on page two, where you have the federal and state revenue sources, and you list out the SIS highway construction right-of-way, Manatee County versus Sarasota County, where do those numbers come from?
Those come from FDOT, and we will follow their SIS plan as we adopt the long-range plan. That's the projects and the funding that they have available to expand 75 and those and seven State Road 70 and those major.
So the significant difference between Sarasota and Manatee County is due to what?
That I'll have to defer to DOT. I don't know why there's a difference in the funding between the two.
Maybe they could come in. We had some presentations on that a couple of meetings ago, but it seems like it's always a moving target.
I would imagine the main reason on the, oh, sorry, Laura Lockwood with FDOT. I would imagine the main reason on that could be the number of miles on the SIS system, the number of miles on the facilities on the SIS system, and or what we actually have in our SIS plan, our 2040 SIS plan as well, for needed improvements or identified improvements.
Okay. Then there is something on page four that I had checked with our staff in the local option fuel taxes. And this is of concern to me because it's something that we're voting on in our board meeting tomorrow. But I, there was a statement here. It says, according to the local government financial information handbook, Manatee County does not distribute local option fuel tax revenues to its municipalities. Well, that may be true that it's in the local government financial information handbook that way. However, that is incorrect.
Okay.
And I did get verification from our financial department that, in fact, that we do. And I see a shaking head from one of our municipalities. So perhaps you could, I can forward this email, or Saji can forward the email that we got from our financial people, but that does need to be corrected.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Mr. Barrow.
Thank you, Chairman. My question is, how does FDOT give you a budget without their knowing what the federal government's going to do?
This was actually established a couple of years ago. They do an annual revenue every year. We've used the one from end of 2013 that all the MPOs are using, and that was at that time what was forecasted to be available based on current policies and legislation.
And we get the Florida Department of Transportation gets about 20 to 25% of its budget from the federal government. Is that correct?
I believe something around. Yep.
So we're self-funded about 75 to 80% of the time from our own general funds.
For the federal and federal?
No. For all the roadway projects that are state related.
State and regional.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay. So this. You could have a much better presentation for the board in September if they were to make a deal in Washington, in that real functional place they call Washington, D.C.
Dave Hutchinson.
You're on the welcome, Dave.
Executive Director. This plan, the 2040 plan, must utilize the estimates provided by FDOT,
right,
which were developed with federally approved methodologies. After you adopt in December a 2040 plan, if we have new federal numbers that would allow us to amend the plan, that would come later.
Okay, so sometime in the first quarter of 16, we might be able to have a better budget.
That would be great if we could.
Maybe.
Sorry for all the novice questions, but since I'm sitting in here for someone, I'm sort of curious. Thank you.
Do we have a, yes. Yeah.
Yes, thank you. Ditto on some of the comments already asked in regards to the uncertainty at the federal level. But it's interesting that the projections here in the forecast are identifying reductions at the higher levels. And what's concerning to me is the shift in looking at the local jurisdictions for funding some of these things. And I can say to you that we are facing the same crisis.
Yes.
So, and if anything, at the local level, we absolutely have some options, but there's some constraints with achieving those. So, for example, if we wanted to have, for within our city, we wanted to add a fuel tax in addition to what's there, we cannot do that unless the whole rest of the county votes on it. But yet it would only be in the city, you know, our jurisdiction. So some of those constraints are you know, really having a bearing on how we are going to accomplish what we need to. And I can tell you, with Northport being only 30% developed and already seeing what we need, we have multi-million dollar needs in our community, and I'm concerned with a shift at looking at some of the local jurisdictions' funding, because it's not there. The shift in the mobility fees from impact fees.
Yes.
That's a concern, and it's still something that, in some cases, that actually is lower. So, and now you're taking the funding that was dedicated for surface transportation, and you're not necessarily adding to the funding in the pool. You're now dividing it and basically slicing it even more for the bike and the pedestrian, which you can't do with impact fees right now. So I'm just very concerned at the emphasis in here in regards to that, because I'm just not confident that that's a viable place to be looking.
At the regional, you're referring to allocating those other arterial funds to the regional roadway network.
We have some uncertainties. And the question I'm going to put before you is whether you want to just have a consensus that the plan will go forward with this policy statement, or do you want a motion to that effect? Really, the motion is basically based upon the fact that we've corrected some data, but that we are looking at almost total uncertainty about what's going to happen, and we have certain rules we have to follow in developing this plan, which are being followed, and they're limiting. So I'll take a motion if someone wants to make it. If
it's just
not,
information.
Yeah, it's just an informational item, sir.
Pardon me?
It's a non-action item, sir.
It's a non-action item, Mr. Chairman.
We'll make those corrections to the report, and then we'll take the comments and the direction as we first develop that in first financially feasible plan, and we come back to you in September. And then we'll have more formal action.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
FDOT, we now have three good down-to-earth meaty projects you're going to talk about, and see if you can put them into 20 minutes. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Chris Ziegler. I'm the FDOT project manager for the US 41 resurfacing project. As a part of that project, we're planning on adding a right turn lane and traffic separator to US 41 from Gulfstream up to Fruitville Road. As I said, this is going to be a part of the Millen Resurface Project, which goes all the way from Browning Street to south of 11th Street. The traffic separator and right turn lane, though, will just be from Gulfstream up to Fruitville Road. Back in around the wintertime, after receiving complaints from residents and others in the area, our traffic operations department went out and looked at the traffic data along this roadway, made some observations, and developed a plan to help alleviate some of the traffic flow between Gulfstream and Fruitville Road. And the right turn lane is what they came up with. So this is US 41. This is Gulfstream right here. So the traffic separator will go all the way up here to Fruitville Road. We'll have right turn lane, the entire length, that goes into a right turn slip lane onto Fruitville Road. The traffic separator will be down by Gulfstream. The traffic separator will be about as wide as the existing median. Then it'll taper down to about 4 feet wide, all the way up to Fruitville Road. The traffic lanes for this entire segment will be 10 feet wide. And then at the slip lane right here, we will have a traffic signal to stop the right turning movements when a pedestrian is there. It will be a pedestrian activated traffic signal that'll help stop that traffic when pedestrians are crossing. So we'll be adding the right turn lane and median separator by eliminating the bi-directional left turn lane that exists within that segment of roadway. As a result of that, we need the median then to restrict those left turn movements, since there won't be any room for the left turn vehicles to store. If we didn't leave it there and we continue to allow the left turn movements, then the cars will stop and wait. We'll have to wait within the travel lane to make a left turn, which will cause more congestion. The plan is the right turn lane will help alleviate the traffic congestion from Gulfstream up to Fruitville. It'll also improve some of the backup that takes place along Gulfstream from traffic trying to get off of the islands. We actually implemented a temporary improvement to the section of roadway back in the springtime. Those changes demonstrated that this improvement would improve the traffic flow. So we are currently in the final design stage of this project. We anticipate construction to take place in the summer 2016. The total cost of construction for the resurfacing project is $5.9 million. The traffic separator and turn lane improvements is estimated at $280,000. We have a public hearing scheduled for August 3rd. That will be from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. at the Selby Library in downtown Sarasota. If anybody else would like to, that's for the general public and anybody that would like to find out more about the project. And there's my contact information if anybody has any more questions, and I can answer any other questions you have right now.
Thank you, Chris. Questions or comments from the board? Yes, Ms. Chapman.
My concern is, what is this separator going to consist of? Is it just a concrete wall?
We're actually planning on reutilizing the concrete pavers that are out there right now to fill in for the center of the concrete separator, of the traffic separator. And if we can't do that, we're working with city staff on some other decorative treatments, like a stamped concrete on the top of it.
Anything else? Yes.
That was going to be my same comment that I made at our city commission meeting, is that we don't want something that looks like a concrete abutment going up that road. You know, I mean, you've got to make sure that that medium looks attractive. We're working on making the section between Gulfstream and University to become more attractive, and that, you know, that isn't going to help if it isn't.
Anything else? Mr. Younger.
I'd just like to say that whole Gulfstream Fruitville interchange is a critical traffic bottleneck right now. It's going to become even more so when the view is completed. You're creating a canyon-like effect in there. The right turn lane that was put in several months ago has helped that traffic flow some. And what you are talking about is what I commonly refer to as low-hanging fruit. You've got a fast fix in an area. I believe during the long term there will be a traffic circle that is planned for that interchange, and there will be an opportunity at that point to make that a very attractive section. But this is an intermediate repair, and I certainly understand the divider in the center, and if you can make it attractive, that's good. But I often come out of the library and continue down First Street in an attempt to turn left. I probably shouldn't be doing that, but I do it because I can. And I also do it because Fruitville is problematic to get on. I think that what you're proposing is an excellent short-term solution for that area. And as I say, that area is bad now. It's terrible to move the traffic off of the islands to get them on the Fruitville. And anything we can do to help that area move the traffic would be wonderful. And anything you can do to create a divider that would be aesthetically appealing would also be wonderful too.
Thank you. Anything else? Yes, Liz? Yes.
Okay. I just have another comment about, and I understand the need to get the traffic moving through there, but when you close off the street grids, I mean, we're just going to have people going to the lights and holding people up because they're making a U-turn because they need to get to wherever they needed to get on the other side. So I don't know, you know, I hope it's helpful, but I think you're creating other problems when you're doing this as well. Not to mention harder to cross, there's going to be six lanes.
So,
the only place to get to over there is Joey D's Pizza. And I don't see that being an encumbrance to traffic. We have traffic dividers running up and down Tamiami Trail. We have them down in the neighborhood of another critical area, Bee Ridge. And they work well. People will get to where they need to get to, and yes, there will be some U-turns. There always is. There are U-turns at Bee Ridge for various reasons, but for the most part, I believe that it would smooth the traffic flow.
Anything else? Part of this is going to also be dealt with in your third report where you're beginning the roundabout stuff, so. Okay, you got those comments. You're going to have fun with them, I'm sure. Next one. This is 15th Street. Now Manatee gets some attention now.
Good morning. My name is Amy Setchell. I'm here with FDOT. And I'm here on behalf of David Turley, who fell ill yesterday and wasn't able to attend, so I'm going to give his presentation for him, so please bear with me. I'm here to present on the status of the 15th Street East / 301 Boulevard East PD&E study from Tallavass Road to US 41. As I said before, David Turley is the acting FDOT project manager in the PD&E group. The project limits are along 15th Street from Tallavass to US 41. The PD&E study is looking at widening from the existing two-lane typical section out there to a three-lane, not for capacity, but to use that middle lane as a center two-way left turn lane. It's also going to be looking at adding bicycle lanes, sidewalks, pedestrian crossings, bus stop improvements, and street lighting. This is one of the typical sections. Whoops, let me back up. This is typical section number one. And there you can see some of the improvements. That center lane is not for capacity, it's for those turning movements. You have sidewalks, wider sidewalks than a typical DOT 5-foot. You also have the bike lanes. Whoops. This is a typical section. Typical section number two, this is going to go from north of 63rd East to 55th Avenue East, has a design speed of 40 miles an hour, encompasses some of the same features with a 10-foot wider path, 5-foot bike lanes. Each typical section has been developed for different areas based upon some of the right-of-way constraints. That's why you might see some of the parameters vary from each one. This is typical section number 3. This is approaching State Road 70. You have the constraint of the cemetery. So that's changing a few of the elements. And here's the last typical section. It matches some of the previous ones, and this is going to go from 51st to US 41. The intent of this PD&E and looking at the new typical section is this is a rendering of the existing today. When we go to the next one, this will be a rendering of when we put that turn lane in with the pedestrian improvements. And eventually could go to redevelopment of some of the businesses along there. To tie into that, you could have storefronts tying into the multimodal corridor with the complete streets feel of the lighting, landscaping, pedestrian features, and the transit opportunities. This PD&E has been underway for several months now, coming up to the milestone of an alternatives public workshop. That's going to be on August 27th. They're going to, they'll have boards available for the public to look at. All the typical sections will be presented, and it'll show some of the improvements they're looking on, and that's going to be the first milestone to really get public input on the support of the project. That'll be followed up with a public hearing in December, scheduled tentatively right now for December 3rd. With that, I'll open it up to any questions.
Yes, Mr. Chaffee.
Yes, it would appear at the intersections, you're just looking at typical intersections, no roundabouts.
Oh, that was my question.
You know, this is complete streets, multimodal, a lot of opportunity for revitalization, redevelopment, this whole corridor. You know, it is a key connector, I think, between Sarasota, Manatee, downtown Bradenton, Sarasota, just another north-south route. Why not roundabouts?
And maybe I didn't make that clear because I didn't have any slides specific to the intersection, but each intersection we are evaluating them for a roundabout opportunity.
Yes, Betsy.
First of all, I want to say thank you very much to FDOT staff for working very closely with our staff. This is an extremely important corridor in our TIF area where we're looking for redevelopment. Mm-hmm. I echo Commissioner Chappie's comments about roundabouts, that we should mm-hmm. be looking at that. But we really appreciate the hard work that's gone into this so far. I did have a question, and it actually came up during the long-range transportation plan update where it said that 15th was in the funded category. And as we know, it's not in the funded category. So anything that we can do, we have stumped for funding in Tallahassee, we have stumped for funding in Washington, and we appreciate the help of the MPO to continue to make this a priority, because this multimodal corridor is going to be extremely important for connection throughout Manatee County and into Sarasota. And if you go into Sarasota and you look at Old Bradenton Road, you see some of the cool things that have been done.
That's right.
And I ride my bike down that way, so I know that it is multimodal. Yeah. So, you know, we need to continue to keep our eye on the prize to try to keep moving this forward for funding. So just want to say thank you.
Vanessa.
Actually, Mr. Chaffee asked about the roundabouts. That was going to be my question.
Okay. Anything else? Mm-hmm.
Yes, my question is, given that there are multimodal emphasis on this, why are the design speeds so fast? When I attended two long-range transportation plan sessions, people complained that they could not walk across streets safely because of the design speeds were so high and the lanes were so wide, and it was very difficult for both bicyclists and pedestrians when the speeds were high. So I'm wondering, if we're going to emphasize multimodal, why are we having such fast design speeds?
That's something I'll definitely have to follow up on.
Yes. Linda.
Looking at the typical section number 1, mm-hmm. And then comparing that to the rest that follow, when I see a 4-foot bike lane, mm-hmm. you know, that's narrow than most of the others. And but the thing that stood out is there's a 4-foot bike lane in this section, which is a 45-mile-an-hour design speed, whereas the rest of the three typicals in here are 5-foot bike lanes with 40-mile-an-hour.
Okay.
So I just wanted to raise that, and you know, I think the 5-foot, 4 bike lanes that are right next to the travel lanes of the vehicles, you know, certainly I'm always for the 5-foot versus the 4-foot.
Okay.
Anything else? Of course, you know, the unintended consequence of this great project is that, number one, staff will be able to get to work on time, and number two, we can assure Mr. Burriff that we will get full attendance. However, if you're coming from Sarasota County, and from I-75 in particular, whosever jurisdiction it is, please do not have the red light to turn into 15th Street. Turn red right after the 301 light turns green, because it backed up almost to 301 this morning, and somebody needs to look at that. Then this will function just beautifully when that's fixed. Next one, this is Main Street and 41.
Thank you, Chair. Board, my name is Aaron Castro, the Department of Transportation. I am the DOT project manager for the US 41 at Main Street roundabout. Well, we so lovingly call it a roundabout because that's what it'll probably end up being. So as we move forward, essentially what you're looking at right now is the project limits, that little gold yellow X that you're seeing on there. I know it's kind of hard to see from where you are, is essentially our project limits for the roundabout itself. We do have it up here on the board in my general direction as well. The other areas that you see kind of highlighted out in the color would be the area that we would be taking into consideration for the project. That would include the 41 corridor, also the downtown area, Marina Jacks, and also Gulfstream, because of the proximity to Main Street. Purpose of the project is basically to evaluate the engineering and the environmental effects that would be happening at this intersection, so that way you could construct a roundabout in the future. The need for the project comes for the improvement connectivity. It would follow the circulation for the Bayfront connectivity plan, and it would also enhance the safety within the area, essentially your downtown area where a lot of your walking peds bikes happen to be. To give you a brief overview, PD&E study, for those that aren't really familiar with it, right now we're in the data collection stage of the PD&E study. We would be moving on to the development and the analysis for alternatives. From that point, we will move on to a public information workshop, where we will be coming back to you guys basically to say, hey, we've got some pretty new things to look at, you know, give us some input, and we're going to go to the public and get input on it. From there, we would move to a public hearing where, again, we gather public input, and then we move on to final acceptance if so moved. During the development and analysis of alternatives, we would build alternatives. These are things that would basically be, look, here's a roundabout, here's another roundabout, or here's what we'd also consider the no build. No build would carry through the entire PD&E process as stated and as by law. We would also present the build alternatives at the workshop and the public hearings, making refinements as we move along the process. Right now, the We Are Here is where we are in the study schedule. We are just finishing up data collection, moving into analysis, and we would be very soon coming up with developing the alternatives.
Move too fast. Thank you. Are there questions or comments on this one? Yes, Mr. Younger. I can take
over. This is, I think the roundabout's an excellent idea, but I also recognize that in this area, there's a lot of pedestrian traffic. And the amount of pedestrian traffic in conjunction with the roundabout may create a little unique situation there. And I have a suspicion that it might be worthwhile in this area to consider a pedestrian underpass in conjunction with this, gently sloping, which would be handicap accessible with the sloping, which would certainly be preferable to an overpass. And I would suggest that it be taken a look at to help the pedestrian flow and the traffic flow in this area.
We could definitely, you know, take a look at that, keep it in consideration.
Mr. Barrows.
I'm mimicking the comments the gentleman just made. Gil Waters, for years, has been trying to create either an pedestrian overpass or underpass, whatever makes more sense, in order to get the downtown more connectivity to the waterfront.
Yes.
They have a beautiful park there, and people, you know, some people lose interest because crossing Tamiami Trail can be hazardous to your health. So, if that's the appropriate time to make those kinds of considerations is now, then I agree with the gentleman.
Thank you.
Anything else on this one? Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We have concluded the FDOT presentation. We now have anything from Bessie on T-BARTA?
The last T-BARTA meeting was in June, so I wasn't here at the June 22nd, so I guess you didn't have a report. T-BARTA did approve the master plan at their June meeting, did take into account everything that is shown in our local master plans, and there's coordination there, so that's a good thing. I know most of you have heard that T-BARTA is looking for local funding. That has come up, is being discussed by all of the different jurisdictions, so I won't go into that now, but that's something that has come up about how to continue to fund T-BARTA. And our next meeting is in August, and I can't remember the date.
I'm sure we'll see that come before us.
I will continue to let you know what happens at T-BARTA.
Vicki Neuschwander, you want to speak? You got a very good article in the newspaper the other day.
Thank you for this opportunity to speak to all of you. With the increase of crashes as a consequence of growth, and as you probably also know that there are various county, state, and state departments and municipal departments that focus on different aspects of the crash data for an assortment of purposes. As public servants, knowledge of local safety and health issues should be paramount in decision-making processes, including development approvals. I would like to recommend the following endeavor to enhance the knowledge base and analysis process. At an upcoming MPO meeting, have a panel presentation by the various entities that deal with crash data to inform all of us on county municipal I-75 and its intersections. The data on crashes, what are they? What are the, for instance, trends over the last 5 years, locations of high incidences of crashes, analysis of crashes at high incidence locations, and analysis of crashes at existing roundabouts before millions of dollars are spent on this issue. What comes to mind particularly is the Jacaranda issue and all the crashes that exist there. Granted, it is at a slower pace, but there still are a lot of crashes, and I think there's some need to look at the senior population and how they evaluate those situations. Certainly, on my dream list, however, is a community dialogue with like a town hall meeting or something like that, with all the politicians, planners, and begin the dialogue on the consequences of growth. Be on the front end of this thing instead of cleaning up the various issues that happen when you don't pay attention to these kinds of events that are now facing us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any member comments? Betsy.
I just want to know, we were asked about Rob Warner and having a proclamation. Does that take a vote by this board to do that? I did not know Mr. Warner passed away, so I'm very sorry to hear that. He was, you know, very active, wrote me lots of emails, so I'm really sorry to hear that. But do we need to make a motion to have a proclamation? And if so, I will do so.
I think staff can work something up on that. Unless you want anything formal. Well, I don't think it's necessary to have anything formal.
Let me make sure that I understand the earlier comments and that there is a consensus that there be some type of plaque developed for Rod. And what was the second thing?
That's it. I was just going to make a motion if we needed a motion to have a proclamation recognizing
and
his
proclamation.
Service.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Okay. Yep.
I'll take one if anybody wants to make it.
I think that's
second.
Appropriate.
Second.
Doesn't hurt.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Thank you, Betsy. Any other member comment? Yes, Linda.
I just want to say very quickly, but Mr. Howe, thank you so much for your service. It's been a pleasure to work with you. And also, I want to express my sincere appreciation to Mr. Hutchinson. Welcome aboard, and thank you so much for your considerations and working with the committee and coming up with a contract. And I look forward to you serving us very well.
Hear, hear.
Thank you, Linda. Any other member comments? If not, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Second. No vote necessary. Thank you. Meeting's adjourned.